Welcome to Real Talk, Urban League Twin Cities virtual town hall forum on pressing topics for Black people and the Black community. I am Stephen Belton, President and Chief Executive Officer of Urban League Twin Cities and your host for Real Talk. We are in the midst of an ongoing pandemic, which is the public health crisis of COVID-19. So before we get into our discussion, I want to point to some available resources for dealing with the coronavirus. Partial list should be on the screen or will be shortly. Please email the Urban League at info@ultcmn.org or check out our website for more information about the coronavirus. Our website is ultcmn.org. I also want to remind you of the importance of completing the census, the US Census, the census that comes out every 10 years. And please complete the census for your household. African Americans continue to be undercounted, which undercuts the money and other resources that flow into our community. Just one example, the distribution of dollars in response to the pandemic will be based on population statistics collected through the census. So it is not too late. The federal deadline for completing the census has been extended through October of this year, I believe. If you have not filled out the census form and sent it in, you can fill it out either online, you can do it in person, or you can do it via mail. Please fill out the census today. Also, please take a quick moment or quick minute before or after the conversation to join the Urban League movement in its support of the George Floyd Justice and Policing Act, which has already passed the United States House of Representatives and now faces an uphill battle in the United States Senate. The link is posted on the screen. There should be a link posted on your screen and also will be posted in the chat for those who'd like to copy and paste their support of George Floyd Justice and Policing Act. Efforts underway to defund police departments here in Minneapolis and in cities across the country continue to make headlines and dominate public discourse and private conversations from Congress to city halls, boardrooms to bedrooms, playgrounds to pulpits. The timeliness and audacity of the demand to defund comes on the heels of the untimely but equally audacious public execution of George Floyd by former Minneapolis Police Department officers Derek Chauvin, Tu Tao, Thomas Lane, and J. Alexander King. That moment, those horrific 8 minutes and 86 seconds, pulled back the curtain of denial and laid bare the ugly truth of lethal and weaponized racism in the hands and at the knees of police who target Black bodies. In our shared anger, outrage and mourning, people of all races have demanded fundamental transformative change to the culture, system, and purview of policing. As is not an option. Same old is a non-starter. The time for tinkering or incremental change has passed. But how far and how fast should we go in transforming the police? And where do we start? For some activists and for the entire Minneapolis City Council, the answer is to defund the police department. But what exactly does that mean? In our last Real Talk 2 weeks ago, we invited a panel of experts and activists to explore what it means to defund the police. We discussed a variety of impacts and options for a systemic transformation and talked specifically about the City Council's proposal to change the Minneapolis Charter. Today, we want to hear your voices and learn from you. Our topic, Defund the Police, Speak Your Peace, is intended to elicit a variety of responses reflecting the diverse experiences and perspectives of our community. You are the expert, the activist, the resident, the neighbor, the opinion leader, and the stakeholder. And in this Real Talk, we want to open up the virtual floor for as many of you to speak as possible. So if you are on Zoom, we invite you to use the chat box to write your questions. We will be monitoring the chat box. One of our staff is monitoring the chat box, and we will read those questions aloud or call on you to ask your question and comment or make your comment live. If you are joining us by Facebook Live, please write your questions in the comment section on Facebook Live, and one of our production team will place it or rewrite it in the Zoom chat box. We may not get to everyone, but we will get as many voices into the forum as time will allow. Please note that Real Talk is recorded and later archived on our website. So we have dispensed with our usual panel today so that we can hear from you. But I did invite one special guest, a sort of one-person panel. And believe me, she is uniquely positioned to add value to today's topic. Please join me in welcoming Leslie Redmond, who is president of the Minneapolis NAACP. Leslie is a public speaker, an equity expert, an activist, and a civil rights advocate, and an attorney. She is something of a prodigy. At the tender age of 20, she had lunch with President Barack Obama. At the age of 25, she became the youngest president of the Minneapolis NAACP. Now, still at the tender age of 27, she has earned her Juris Doctorate degree as well as her Master's in Business Administration, and she was recently admitted into the Minnesota Bar. Leslie is often at the center of civil rights advocacy in the Twin Cities and is known for her Don't Complain, Activate, or DCA campaign. Welcome to Real Talk, Leslie.
Grace and peace, Reverend Belton. Thank you so much for having me here. And I am now 28. I had a birthday recently.
Yeah, I was trying to give you that little extra year, but you just jumped on to see truth to power. So 28 years old, still a very tender age. I used to be 28. That was like 5 minutes ago in my mind.
Back in the day.
Back in the day. Well, let's get started. As we mentioned earlier, there is no common understanding of the term defund the police. Even among those who advocate that position, there is no common ground on what it means or what it would or what it should do with the funds, what we should do if we reallocate after defunding. There's no solid agreement or consensus on what our priorities are for public safety. So Leslie, let me begin with you before I turn this question to the audience for their input. How do you define defund the police? What is your understanding of that term?
So my understanding of defunding the police is extracting resources from the Minneapolis Police Department and money that would typically go to them in their budget and actually moving it towards community resources and outlets, which on the surface, I'm not against. Do you want me to go into what I feel about it, or just let me just tell you what I know it to be?
Speak your truth, Leslie.
Okay, so I am on the surface not against that, right? I always tell people I can really understand all perspectives, in this conversation, the first thing that I think about is obviously when we think about the nature of the police department and its roots, it is from slave patrols, right? I don't think that anyone can object to the brutality, the terrorism, and the horror that has happened to the Black community at the hands of the police departments all over the United States, but specifically the Minneapolis Police Department. Myself, when I see those sirens go off, I'm terrified. You know, I feel like the police could literally come and murder me. And it's not a joke, you know, and I don't take my life or any other Black person's life lightly. Now, with that being said, right now we are in a situation where I have more trust that if something was to happen to me, the police will be held accountable, which is something that we haven't typically seen in Minneapolis. Similar to you, Reverend Belton, I have a tremendous amount of respect for Chief Arredondo, our first African-American police chief, who I believe is doing a tremendous job. I think he is the best chief in the nation. It may be the best chief that we've ever had. What he did with this George Floyd situation is amazing. It's something that we've never seen done.
Unprecedented. You know,
it's unprecedented. And right now, they are still calling for Breonna Taylor killers to be arrested. So I don't really know if people value what we have in Minneapolis and how long we've fought for this moment, right? Like, I remember 5 years ago with Jamar Clark, we weren't dealing with the same situation. We weren't dealing with a police chief who actually cared about the Black community, who held officers accountable, right? We weren't dealing with a governor who was willing to be courageous enough to take the case from the Hennepin County Attorney Mike Freeman's office and give it to the first African-American Attorney General, Keith Ellison, office, right? And so for me, it's about putting things into perspective and also recognizing that just simply pulling funds from the Minneapolis Police Department is not going to solve the problem. When I think about the Hennepin County Sheriff's Office, when I think about the state troopers right there, and I personally, if we were taking money from anybody, it would be Hutch and the Sheriff's Office first, but you know, that's a whole nother topic.
Sounds like we need to get you back for real talk to talk about the Sheriff's Department, but let's move on.
Because I have a specific issue with them. But anyways, when it comes to the Minneapolis Police Department, I agree that obviously we need to reimagine what policing looks like, right? But I also think that Chief Arredondo should be at the forefront of that conversation. And I do not believe that he has been at the forefront of that conversation. I think that he has, even before this, me and him, and I know you have had meetings with him, I have standing meetings with him. We've been working for a long time to work this out. And I see that Councilmember Ellison is on the call. Hey, Councilmember Ellison. You know, we were out there on West Broadway when the white supremacists, you know, were quote unquote coming and was burning down buildings. And we definitely know that white people were responsible for a number of our buildings burning. And we actually put a police patrol. And I will say shout out to Councilmember Ellison because he was riding around as we were patrolling and protecting the community as well. And so I have an appreciation for people who are on the ground who recognize our communities do need to be protected. You know, one of the things I like to say, Reverend Belton, is I don't think the police precincts actually need to be in our community. I think they're more so like occupying space, almost like we're in the middle of a war. And I don't think that is productive. I think places like the fourth precinct that have barbed wires around them could go back to being the way. I think since the third precinct has been burned down, when it is rebuilt, it doesn't need to be rebuilt. As a precinct, just so you all know, it's not my birthday. I'm sorry, I see the comments below. I said I had a recent birthday, so thanks. I'll still take the birthday love. But I think these precincts could actually be utilized as community centers. So that's something that I will push forward. I also think that we could have community policing like we've already created. And we could pour resources into emergency response teams and a number of things. But I also think that there's a role that the police could serve in. And I think the reality of it is that even if the Minneapolis Police Department is defunded, they don't go away. And there's still so many other entities. And so I think we really need to look at the nuance and how complicated this issue is. And I think that Chief Arredondo, not just as a leader, but as a Black conscious leader, needs to be at the forefront of this conversation. Because I'm not an expert the way Chief Arredondo is, and I would trust Chief Arredondo with my life, Reverend Belton, and I wouldn't say that about a lot of people. When Chief Arredondo was coming down checking on us when we were on West Broadway, I felt like Santa Claus was coming on Christmas. Like, I felt safe. I felt like, and I feel like right now, if a police officer was to murder me, I feel like Chief Arredondo would hold him accountable. You get what I'm saying? Like, I don't feel that same way when I come to my home state of DC. I don't, listen, I'm just saying that, like, there needs to be a lot of reimagining. There needs to be a lot of transformation and reform. And Chief Arredondo needs to be at the forefront of that conversation versus
let me get into this a little bit and maybe disperse some comments from groups. So you're pushing really hard that Chief Arredondo is an extraordinary and exceptional police chief. He's the right person for right now, and that he needs to lead the discussion about transformation. And yet the ordinance that's been proposed, the change to the charter, some people argue, my voice has been among them, but I'm not going to speak for my voice, but have argued that there's language in it, that the language in there that specifies that the person who leads this new Department of Public Safety would have to be someone who has a background in either, you know, in violence or in public health, violence prevention, restorative justice, that sort of thing. A lot of people have taken that to mean that it's a specific tag or effort to preclude Chief Arredondo from leading that department. How do you see that? And do you see those as inconsistent?
Well, one thing, since Council Member Ellison is on the call, I would love for him to put in the chat what he thinks it means. I would be interested in seeing that, and maybe you can read that off, Reverend Belton, when it comes up. For me, again, it's kind of like, again, we were on West Broadway. Me and Chief Arredondo were working together, and the community was kind of leading the path. And I think that that is something that could be useful and utilized. I think that we have to acknowledge the mistrust, the very valid mistrust that we have of government entities and police departments and just state institutions overall, because they have betrayed our community in the past. And I don't want to tokenize Chief Arredondo, because he won't always be the police chief, right? And so we have to prepare for a time where the community is in control and the community is leading the way versus these state institutions leading us. And that's what I would like to see. When we talk about who that person needs to be, I think that it needs to be a person who does have some sort of experience. But one of the things that I also like to say is that as a Black person in America, we have experienced racism, even not just in the physical, but as people for over 400 years, we know exactly what it looks like. And we are experts in our own right. And I think a lot of the time these credentials try to count some of us out and count some of us in. And honestly, I don't know exactly what the agenda of the city council is. And I don't like to assume too much. And that's why I asked for Council Member Ellison to speak up on it. And a number of them haven't really reached out to me to have conversations. So I don't know what their intention was, but I would tell them that they need to be mindful, because I've felt like for a very long time that the authority and the position of Chief Arredondo has been disregarded and disrespected in a number of entities. And I believe that a number of police officers have quit because they do not want to answer to a Black man. I think that we have to be very careful not to cripple his leadership during this time, because I do think that he has a plan and there's a real opportunity for transformation and change. You know, one of the things he did was created a new oath for the police department. And again, I know that this is not the be all end all, but people have to understand, Rome wasn't built overnight. The United States wasn't built overnight. These police forces weren't built overnight. So it's going to take time, brick by brick, to change them, right? And his oath, Reverend Belton, who actually, you were supposed to administer the oath with me. So it's supposed to be the Urban League and the NAACP. So shout out to you, Reverend Belton. The oath, as you saw, talked about valuing the humanity of everyone. It talked about the duty not to cause harm. It talked about the duty to protest, both verbally and physically, when you see somebody's rights being violated, right? Like, I think Chief Arredondo is taking the right steps, in my opinion. He has a whole plan that he wants to roll out. And actually, I had Dr. Raj and Anika Bowie actually speak to the new recruits. This is something that wasn't done before. I think people have to understand. You know what I mean? We didn't have this direct connect to impact the new recruits and top leadership, for them to see that our lives do matter. And I don't think ever in America we've had this opportunity. And if we are not intentional, we don't take advantage of it, I think it'll be a real missed opportunity. So for me, I want to work with Chief Arredondo. For me, I support Chief Arredondo's leadership. And in addition to that, I also want to see transformation and reform. I also don't want to see their police precincts in our community. I also want to see resources put to community policing initiatives. I think both things can be true.
So let me bring in, I'm going to actually ask our producers if you can unmic Councilmember Ellison. But before we get to him, let me read a question that was sent in earlier by John Stout, who's at the Fredrickson Law Firm. He's a well-known corporate lawyer. He writes, defund the police. It makes a good soundbite in a terrible national marketing piece for Minneapolis as violence spikes. We need thoughtful public safety discussion, which brings needed reforms. We also need clear public support for the officers who serve us well and are needed wherever we call, whatever we call the new iteration of police department. With some of the careless comments by the council and other officials, we'll lose some very good officers to other places by resignation and relocation to communities where they feel their work is appreciated. I'd love to see some much needed responsible reforms, but I'm also concerned that the current comments, cliches, and thoughts as portrayed in the media serve us poorly.
So can I respond to that?
Let me see if we got, is Councilmember Ellison on the line, and then go ahead, Leslie.
Okay. You want me to wait for Councilmember to respond first?
No, you were amped up and ready to go, so go ahead.
Hey, Councilmember Ellison.
Hey, how's it going, Leslie? Yeah, please.
No, I'm blessed. Fine. Good to see you always. You need to call me too so we can chop it up soon.
Okay, yeah,
but, I will. Okay, so that's my response. I have two responses, right? So my first response is, similarly, I have a great amount of respect and appreciation for officers who do their job, right? But the reality of the situation is, if we're being honest and transparent, the police really haven't been reducing crime in our community. I've never seen where the police have actually intervened and stopped crime from taking place. And I know that's a bold statement to make, but I'm going to make it and I'm going to stand on it, because I've sat and watched the police wait for a crime to take place. And I've asked them, why did y'all not intervene? And they said a crime hadn't taken place yet, right? So I think that, to the point that was made, I don't think in the large scheme of things, it is helpful to put out this agenda without a plan, because it does give people the illusion that it's okay for a crime to take place. But crime is spiking all over, even places where these defunding conversations are not having. An 11-year-old boy was just hit in crossfire in Washington, D.C. One of my really dear friends was just hit in crossfire and died in D.C. a couple months ago. So I don't want us to make correlations where there are not correlations. I do know from people on the ground that police officers have told young Black inner city kids that are involved in activity that they shouldn't be involved in, is that they're basically not going to intervene, and that they basically have at it, which is not helping. So, like, I think that we have to get to the deep-rooted issues of this and the idea of what they're supposed to do and what they should do. I agree that we definitely need a lot of reform and we need alternatives, but I don't want to give the police undue praise that they definitely don't deserve, because I always am very clear that I have a tremendous amount of respect and appreciation for Chief Arredondo, but he obviously is not represented by all of his officers, because we know that we have officers like Officer Chauvin who have their knees on the necks of Black bodies every day. And when I watched that video, I felt like not only did Officer Chauvin intend to murder George Floyd, but I feel like he was taking a stab at Chief Arredondo. I think he knew that they were recording. I think he knew that that was coming out. And I think that the officers that are leaving, this is my last thing, Reverend Belton, I think the officers that are leaving are actually the officers that need to be leaving. That's my theory. I actually don't think that we're losing the good officers. I think that we're losing the shady, racist officers who feel like they're going to be held accountable. That's just my thought.
So I'm sure that'll spur some thought and some comment as well. One of my first thoughts about what you were saying is that we have in this moment an opportunity to do a both and. It doesn't have to be simply either we defund and cause calamity, or we rebuild, but we can actually do both as part of what I think the conversation is. And so much of, maybe this is part of your point, so much of the narrative right now is a zero sum game. It's a binary kind of a deal. Either we can do one or the other. Councilmember Ellison, thanks for agreeing to, for joining Real Talk and signing on as a participant like everybody else, but also offering to, you've been kind of at the epicenter of this. And so maybe you'd like to take us, maybe we could take a step or two backwards and you can tell us what you mean by defund.
Yeah. Well,
so welcome.
Yeah, thank you. And yeah, no, I mostly want to hear folks. So I'll try to keep it as brief as I can. You know, there's a lot to say, so just feel free to cut me off. I'm not going to take offense or be shy. So first, I just want to thank both of you and especially you, Leslie. You know, you guys are both brilliant. I love when I see you both out in community. Leslie, it was great to see you at the helm of these men who were defending West Broadway in North Minneapolis. It was kind of amazing. You know, for anybody who didn't get a chance to see it or get a chance to see the Washington Post, it would be crazy because for like 10 nights in a row, every night I'm going out. And I would always stop at Sammy's as like my first stop just to see how everybody was doing. And you've got all of these grown men with guns and Leslie's telling them what to do, right? And I was just like,
giving them marching orders.
This is amazing. Like, this is amazing. The leadership's amazing. And it was great to see and witness you in action. I do want to say that somebody mentioned that, you know, defund is maybe a great slogan. It's a great sort of three word hashtag, right? But it's not really the truth of what people are asking for, right? It's kind of it paints an incomplete picture is what I'm saying. And at the city council, and I will tell you that there are cities who have taken this approach to use defund as the strategy, right? And so you're seeing cities just, you know, automatically, even already, cities on the East Coast and on the West Coast just cutting large sums of money out of their department without a plan. Our department is large. It has a lot of money, but it doesn't have so much money that we can cut, say, I think New York cut nearly $1 billion out of their police force. So that was the proposal. And so
the total budget for our department is about
$193 million.
Yeah.
And it's a large share of the overall budget. And it's gotten increases, especially in the last 2 years. It's gotten a $4 million increase and then an $8 million increase, respectively. And so for us, the conversation is less about a blanket defunding and more about reimagining public safety, reimagining what public safety can look like. That, to me, that's the real discussion. Now, it's not as, reimagining public safety is not as bold and provocative as defund the police and abolish the police. So it's not going to get printed in a headline in the paper, but it is more of the truth of what we're discussing here. And to me, when we are proceeding forward with this charter change, that is, we're really trying to create the avenue to reimagine public safety. The charter change does not in and of itself reimagine public safety. It creates the space to, because our current charter language locks us into the status quo in a way that I think people maybe don't understand, right? There are ways in which we could go about blanketly defunding the police. We could sort of cut all the civilian positions and make them just sworn officers. I think those are things that we are looking at doing for reasons that those departments like data collection and communications aren't really all that effective in the police department. But more so than a blanket defunding of the police, what we're looking to do is reimagine public safety. So to me, that's what the charter does. There was a question specifically about Chief Arredondo, and I think a few things are important to highlight there. One is that the chief is amazing. I actually do think that he's probably the best chief in the country. And I think that he is committed to cultural change in a way that a lot of police departments, that you don't see from leadership in a lot of police departments. But there are several barriers in his way that undermine his ability to make change. And, you know, to be frank, none of them are the city council. The barriers that exist in the chief's way are threefold. One is the state legislature. that sort of creates the arbitration laws, and I'll give a brief definition of that in a second. The second is the police federation that represents all of the police officers and is democratically elected by those police officers. The chief is not democratically elected by the chief, by the rank and file police officers. And then lastly is the charter that sort of locks us into a, it gives police a monopoly on public safety, meaning that there is no public safety outside of police currently. It's the only strategy for public safety currently. The charter is the only avenue that we can really affect, that the people of Minneapolis can really affect. Just to give a brief definition, of arbitration, which is one of the issues at the state level, arbitration is the process by which if an officer is disciplined, they can appeal that discipline. And that's true for minor discipline, that's true for firings. Now, when a chief in the state of Minnesota, not just Chief Arredondo, but when a chief in the state of Minnesota fires an officer, on average, about 50%, sometimes a little over 50% of those officers are reinstated back onto that force. Now, if an officer has violated the trust of the public so much so that a chief thinks that they need to be fired, arbitration is essentially saying that the chief gets it wrong 50% of the time. Now, when Chief Arredondo fires an officer, do we really think that he's getting it wrong 50% of the time? I don't think so, but that's state law. And that's the position that we have, and there's not a lot that the chief can do once he is given back an officer that he is fired. The thing I'll mention about the federation is that when you look at Bob Kroll as a figure, and we sort of relegate him as a minor annoyance, I think, or is just kind of highly problematic, you have to remember that the chief is appointed by the mayor. Bob Kroll is democratically elected by the rank and file. So if we want to ask ourselves who more represents the values of the rank and file officers who patrol our streets every single day, well, it's Bob Kroll because he is elected by those officers. The existence of Bob Kroll in his role, I think, should tell people just how difficult culture change really is. And the Federation has made it clear in their most recent media blitz that they're not interested in accountability. They actually see accountability as an attack on them. That's the rank and file speaking. So those are the things that I just wanted to name. I'm happy to get into any questions that people have.
Can I ask you a question, Council Member Ellison?
Yes.
Are you okay with that, Reverend Belton?
Absolutely.
So one, I appreciate that, and I actually don't disagree with you that much. I just have a question to add on to what you're saying. So one, I agree with you. I think the legislature and the arbitration is a big barrier. Obviously, we know the Police Federation has and continues to be a big barrier. Now, with that all being said, how much conversation are y'all actually having with Chief Arredondo? How much insight are y'all actually asking Chief Arredondo of what would be helpful for him as the chief moving forward, right? Because similarly, when we think about the police force, and like you said, the rank and file that's actually putting Bob Kroll in a position, it would seem like we need to balance that and give Chief Arredondo an opportunity to work on his new recruit, work on weeding out the bad actors, which he's been doing a really great job at, demoting people, firing people, just without considering the barriers that exist. How much are y'all including him in y'all conversation? How much conversation y'all actually have with him and his vision to reimagine policing?
Yeah, no, I think that's a great question. I'll tell you this. I think that we need to be having probably more conversation with the chief. I'll admit that. I'll admit that he is not at the center of the conversation that we're having currently. But I will say that I agree that he needs to be playing a bigger role. I don't agree that he should be at the helm of the conversation. I think the people of Minneapolis should be at the helm of the conversation. And that would be maybe the one area that I would deviate with, I think, your view, Leslie, but really, by and large, I think we're on the same page. You know, the other thing that I want to say is that we have been leaning into a lot of reforms. And the chief has been at the helm of leading into those reforms. I think they've been a net I think that before George Floyd, I would have told you that they were a net positive. After George Floyd, I'm questioning whether they had an effect. And again, that's not on the back of the chief. That's on this back of the structure that we have. And so I think that.
And I agree with you. And I agree with you that I think it brought a lot of stuff probably to the surface. And that's what I was saying about with Officer Chauvin. And I think a lot of this stuff has to do with backlash. But it's necessary, I think, for progress. And just the two things I would say to you is, one, I would really urge y'all to have more conversations with Chief Redondo, because similar to, I have a lot of respect for Black leadership. I have a lot of respect for Black conscious leadership. And I do not like how we disregard and disrespect their leadership. And I think we see that done even more with Black leaders. And I don't want you all to continue to perpetuate that. So for me, I don't think the community has been engaged in the conversation. So even if we say the community needs to be, I think the community would say that Chief Redondo needs to be at the center of these conversations and need to be brought into more of these conversations more. So I still think there will be alignment there. But yes, I agree that the community needs more input, but And I will acknowledge my bias for the fact that if it wasn't Chief Redondo, I would not be saying this. But because it is Chief Redondo, because he himself sued and won a lawsuit against the Minneapolis Police Department, I don't think there's anybody, and I'm going to be honest with you because I have a real strong conviction around this, I don't think there's anybody more uniquely positioned to be helping reimagine a Minneapolis Police Department than Chief Redondo.
Let me get into this for just a second. So part of, I think what we do have common agreement in our monitoring the chat and looking at all that, everybody agrees that it really is the culture of policing that ultimately we want to get out. That if this, we can use the sort of the medical analogy, that the cancer that we're trying to root out is this racist culture of policing, and that whatever we replace it with cannot replicate that process. And so, you know, again, the medical analogy again is you got to get it all out, because if you don't, then you'll wind up. Or maybe you prefer a less invasive. But think about rust on a car. You know, we all know that in Minnesota, right? If you don't get all that rust out, then you can put all the paint on it, and I guarantee in a year or Minnesota winter, it's coming right back again. The question that I have is, if the real issue, if the cancer that we're trying to get out is the systemic racism, is the unction that you get out of Bob Cole and the Federation that wants no accountability, that believes that a knee to the neck is an appropriate means, all of that mindset, that racist mindset, the question is, what in this charter amendment, what in this process, and I accept, Councilmember Ellison, that what you're trying to do here is provide a platform, it's a reset, it's a moment in a process for the citizens of Minneapolis and for its elected officials and everybody to get at what it is that ails us. I'm wondering what in this process, what in this charter change will really allow us to get at the underlying issue? Because what I worried about when I saw the amendment was that it, no matter what you call it, we can have a Department of Public Safety, we can have a sub-department that's involved with policing. If we don't name racism as the ailment, we're never going to really get it. We'll just wind up
white supremacy. Yeah,
exactly. If we don't get it, that if we don't name that, then what we're going to end up with is my car that's painted over, and in a year you got rust showing through again. So I'm wondering, how do you see this strategy of defunding that is manifest this charter proposal, this change of the proposed change of the charter? How do you envision that is addressing this issue?
Yeah.
Am I being clear?
Yeah, you're being absolutely clear. So I would say that you're absolutely right that in and of itself, the charter change doesn't inherently solve any problem because the status quo is basically possible. The status quo of the current charter is possible with the new charter. But I'll tell you what is also possible with the new charter. If we wanted to go the way of Camden, New Jersey, I saw somebody write about Camden, New Jersey in the chat. What Camden, New Jersey did was they disbanded their police force entirely, relegated policing to the county, and that was how they were able to fire all the officers and make them reapply under a different set of hiring criteria. Under the current charter, we would not be able to do that. Under the new language, we could go that direction if we wanted to. Now, I'm not saying that's necessarily the direction that I want to go, but I'm just sort of giving you a sense of the possibilities of the of what's possible under the new language. You know, I don't think that this council right this second thinks that, you know, abolishing the police is the direction that we're headed. But if you wanted to do that, but under the current charter, that's certainly not possible, right? I think more what we're trying to do at the council is we are trying to end the monopoly that policing has on public safety. Policing has become synonymous with public safety. And yet we see that policing basically only offers one type of response, and that is a punitive response to somebody who has caused harm, right? Now, I can get into a ton of examples about how victims seeking remedy have been left in the dust by a system that only focuses on perpetrators who have caused harm, right? I actually have a really great example, but it's a bit of a story, so I'll leave it unless I'm asked to give it. But then also another thing is that we also don't do anything with regards to prevention. We started the Office of Violence Prevention 2 years ago. It does amazing work. They have a staff of like, you know, four people, right? And so my thing is, why we could develop a system of public safety that has basically three phases: prevention, right? Remedy for victims, and consequences for people who have caused harm. Right now, our current system only has the one, and our current charter only makes the one possible. So that's what I think that the charter does. The charter opens up the possibilities for us to remove the monopoly of public safety away from policing as our sole means of it.
So let me interject a couple of questions that are coming online. So someone on Facebook Live raised the issue. It says that the police precinct, and I don't know which specific precinct they're referring to, Councilmember Ellison, you might have a better idea, or Leslie, says the police precinct is 99.9% white while serving a predominantly Black area. So I'm guessing they're talking about the fourth precinct. Probably talking before. Says, does anyone see that as a problem?
And then, let me
raise another question on Facebook that is related but on a different end of that. It's someone also from Facebook says, it is sad and telling that certain representatives will not address the issues of what is breeding crime in our community. Is that because certain organizations actually profit from crime? So you've got sort of
yes, they profit. We know this. Okay, let me talk about it, Reverend Belton. Yep. So, at the root of all of this, we know white supremacy is the enemy. White supremacy is really the only enemy, right? And a lot of these systems are perpetuating white supremacy, which the Minneapolis Police Department does it, the Hennepin County Sheriff's Office does it, the State Troopers does it, the Minneapolis Public School does it, the healthcare system does it. Almost every institution that we can name is perpetuating white supremacy. We have to also recognize that Black people can perpetuate white supremacy. So while I agree that officers should be more representative of the communities they serve, if there's not a certain level of consciousness there, it will go in vain, right? For example, even when Councilmember Ellison and I were out at Sammy's Avenue Eatery, thank you. Even when we were out at Sammy's Avenue Eatery, I had to remind our brothers, we are not here to replicate what the police have been doing. We don't want our community to be afraid of us. We don't want to be rude, disrespectful. We want to show that we are servicing the community. We were feeding the community. We were giving elderly people rides home who needed rides home, and young people that were out in the middle of the night past curfew that needed a ride home. We were creating a space where we literally are here to protect and serve versus to brutalize. Now, I can say in D.C., growing up in the inner city, because I have to use this example, there were a lot of officers who were actually doing community policing, and I had a lot of relatives. But I will also say that I've seen Black officers perpetuate white supremacy and drag and brutalize Black bodies as well. And actually, I think I'll let that motorcycle pass. Actually, I think that white supremacy does a really great job. If we ever looked at how any system has been infiltrated, whether we're talking about the Black Panthers or COINTELPRO, anything, they usually use Black faces to perpetuate white supremacy. So I just want us to be very careful and very mindful and go back to what Reverend Belton talked about at the beginning, is that this is a culture that it is deeply embedded in the soul. And again, I don't think there's anybody better that knows that than Chief Arredondo. And so I have to continue to push that because, and I also want to say, I appreciate this dialogue that we're able to have because I think it's important. I have a tremendous amount of respect for Reverend Belton. I have a tremendous amount of respect for Councilmember Ellison. And I think that we can disagree, but also see common ground and be able to move forward. And for me, I think that our fight for all of us is Black liberation, and we want to see each other on the end in good. And I just want, I'll be transparent, I just want the city council, I think, to make sure that they're listening a little bit more to the community specifically that are being negatively impacted, that have to deal with this repercussions that is on the ground, and that they're pulling Chief Arredondo and really listening to his expertise. Because I think too often Black people, Black leadership, Black expertise is not respected and is disrespected and disregarded and thrown to the wayside. And so,
and I would add to that, the community itself is often disrespected. I personally believe in the genius and in the integrity, but also in the ingenuity of the community itself. I think we have substantial capacity, not only for problem identification, that is to say, ouch, you're stepping on my foot, but also to say what we need to address that, as in get off my foot or wear lighter shoes or, you know, lean this way. And so part of it requires a commitment on the part of everybody involved, but on particularly on the part of our public elected officials to understand, to value what I regard as the capacity, the genius, and the infinite ability to problem solve that is in our community itself. Would you, I'm seeing nodding heads, so I'm assuming there's agreement.
Yeah, one thing I just wanted to say is, to Leslie, absolutely, I accept that challenge and I appreciate that. And I also appreciate where we can disagree, because we don't have to just live in those disagreements, right? We can also gain understanding and be moved, right? And I think that that's one thing that I always want to push myself to be, is not rigid in my thinking, but to be moved when I hear folks that I respect having a different view than I have. I would say
So let me ask a question of the two of you. So I'm talking to two people who are at least younger than half my age. And so—
Yeah, we're both millennials.
You're both firmly millennials. So I'm wondering, some people have characterized the dissonance within the African-American community about defunding, but also in the broader community. But I want to talk specifically about, the different views that there are, the diversity of opinion. I like to think of it as a dissonance within our community about defunding as a generational divide. My own experience on that belies that, because I know people my age who are like, burn it down, tear it down, abolish the police, later with the police. We don't need the police. But I also know a lot of people in my age group, or in my generation, if you will, who are saying, no. Let's figure out what we're gonna do first, because I do need something there. And before we do away with it, before we take away the funding, I'd like to know where it's going. And I'm also knowing that there are some people in your age group as well, but I'd be interested in how the two of you, both millennials, think about, are you seeing a generational difference in the way that people are approaching? Let me start with you, Jeremiah, or Councilmember Ellison.
Jeremiah's fine.
We do Jeremiah when we're kicking it over coffee, but you're entitled to your propers here.
Yeah, right. He is our brother, but he is your council member, so please respect on his member. Name, period. Right.
So I'd say that there's always probably generally some generational lines, but I tend to agree with you, Steve, that I think by and large, you're gonna find folks of all generations who have all types of views, right? Like, not only are we not a monolith as Black people, we're also not a monolith as Black elders or Black youth, right? And so I think that I tend to agree with you there. And I also wanna just point out that, what's funny about what we're looking to do now, this conversation that we're looking to have to reimagine public safety, is that we have been having that conversation ever since I got into office, right? It was even a part of the conversation while I was running. I would say the difference now, and I think that what a lot of younger organizers, I think, recognize is that, if you have these conversations quietly, then what you get is maybe this kind of inertia, right? You get this ebb and flow of people's urgency. So we got the Office of Violence Prevention funded, but it was funded at a small level, better than nothing. But by and large, policing still has that fix on public safety. Whereas a lot of younger organizers now, they also recognize that maybe defund the police or abolish the police as a slogan is not the whole of the strategy, and the conversation can't live and die there, right? But they also recognize that if they don't say something relatively provocative and something attention grabbing, that the conversation won't actually ever have the kind of urgency that it needs to have. Because even though I think that reimagining the public safety is what we're doing, and it's the more honest maybe phrasing of this conversation, I also have to acknowledge that it's not the kind of phrasing that's going to grab any headlines. It's not the kind of phrasing that's going to invite a massive conversation. And I got to say that, like, as much as I see the shortfalls of defund the police as a slogan, I also understand that without that slogan, without the hashtag, without the buzz both for and against that it generated in social media, we're not having this conversation, I don't think, and as a country. And that's really I think that's the real beauty of it. And that might more than anything be where the generational divide lies, right? Not in the viewpoint, but in the strategy and how to have the conversation.
Rembelson, I just want to jump in real quick. Please. So I agree with Councilmember Ellison. He always takes the words out of my mouth, because I was going to say that we're not a monolith. And I think that we are still enslaved, whether we want to acknowledge it or not. This is something I try to remind us. And this is why I'm not big on symbolic wins. I think symbolically, America told the world that they had freed enslaved Africans. But the reality of the situation, what we're seeing, is that we have never been free in America, right? And some of us are in more bondage than others, like our brothers and sisters that are incarcerated right now in the modern day slavery through the prison industrial complex, right? But our kids are still enslaved in the public education system. Black women are still enslaved with the healthcare system, and Black people overall are enslaved. And so, to Councilmember Ellison's point, I think that you're going to always have different people from different paths. And I don't think it's based on age or race or gender or any of that. I think that we're just all at a different positioning. Some of us will be the hairiest and be the runaway slaves that say, we just F the system and burn it down. There will be some people who are ready to stay and wait it out, right? And say, we need a little bit more strategy. We need a little bit more time. There are other people who don't want freedom. They just want to be the overseer, and they're looking for a pay raise in this season, right? And so I think we have to have that honest conversation about the fact that we're not a monolith, and this is not just a generational divide. This is a liberation divide. Ooh, that was kind of good. The liberation divide is that...
You heard it first right here on Real Talk.
Leslie E. Redmond, Don't Get Flame Activate, said it. And so I think that, and what I want to do is, I want to salute Councilmember Ellis, and I want to salute Candace Montgomery and all the people, because, you know, I seen a little shadiness from people on social media. So let me just address that real quick, saying that the NAACP was being a hindrance to progress, and basically that I was like rubber stamping, we didn't need change. And I don't know where they got that from, and nobody's ever said that with me on the conversation, but I want to acknowledge that that's never what I've been about, right? And the reality of the situation is, I always acknowledge how problematic policing is and how much I do salute the progress that's been made. And I want to say that I wholeheartedly agree that we need extreme conversations about abolishing the police, because I'm not.
And we're in an extreme. We're in an extreme moment right now. We have an opportunity. It would be remiss of all of us, no matter where you fall on this divide, everyone who is conscious, who is woke, who has lived a Black life, for us not to seize this moment where we have everybody's attention. Where, as I said in my opening monologue, that we have pulled back the veil of deniability, yes, about what happens when you weaponize racism, which in fact is, from my perspective, what the policing has been in this country. It was developed, it was created as a way to weaponize white supremacy. And so we have pulled the veil back on that. The deniability is there. We saw a public execution of a Black man because he was Black. It wasn't because he had violated laws. It wasn't because of suspicions. It wasn't because of anything he did. It was because of who he was. And so to not take that moment to move forward, to press forward, I think would be irresponsible. Councilmember Ellison, and both you and Leslie have talked a little bit about what's some of the way out, what are the, some of the other things that we can do, talked about policy. Someone on our, someone who's been writing in the chat line has raised the issue. I think it was Sean Lewis raised the issue. Says 94% of Minneapolis police officers live outside of the city of Minneapolis. Does it matter? He's addressing, of course, this is a state issue because it's state law that prevents cities from having a residency requirement. Minneapolis, the city of Minneapolis, as both of you know, and probably our people who are on this call know, until about 15 or 20 years ago, had a residency requirement where police officers were required to live in the city of Minneapolis. State legislature did that away. I know that our former sheriff, Rich Stanek, had a great hand in moving that forward, but there were others. I'm wondering what your perspective is, trying to focus a little, do a little bit of a pivot from sort of the issue and the, you know, sort of the challenge that we have of whether or not that's part of the solution as well. Do we need to be looking? Does it matter where cops live?
It does matter. I'm sorry. I just want to say real quick, and I'll go to you, Councilman Ellison. It does matter. It does matter where people live. It does matter about the relationships that they have. And I would just add on, and this is because I definitely think I'm revolutionary, so I don't know why people be, you know, but anyways, I think that we need to even think beyond that because there's so many barriers that would even prevent people from our community of getting into these roles and positions, right? Like, we need to talk about how our community has been targeted and now we have felony convictions. We need to talk about how that takes away our Second Amendment right, which I don't think anything should take away our Second Amendment right, to be honest and transparent. Those are the type of changes and transformations that I want to see, is that Even if we reduced all of these barriers, there are so many systemic barriers that white supremacy has presented that we really have to radically rethink what policing looks like and whether that's an alternative that needs to be created to say that we are capable of policing and teaching our own communities, and we don't need the state and institutions built on white supremacy to tell us who is eligible and who is not, because that is a part of the big problem, right? Of who is even eligible for these positions and who are deemed to be uneligible.
Yeah, Councilmember Ellison, what do you think? Does residency matter?
I do think it matters. I also think that it maybe would matter a little less than people think. Again, because I think more than anything, consequences matter. Right. When we talk earlier about, you know, if the chief can't imagine, you're an officer who's been fired by a chief that maybe you already didn't have full respect for. And then arbitration process gets done and you've got your job back. How invincible do you feel in that moment? Probably like nobody could tell you anything. Right. I think that that's a huge problem. I think that, you know, you get a lot of folks also who, a lot of these officers also think that, you know, if I kill someone, there aren't going to really be consequences. At worst, the family of the, if I'm in the wrong, the family of the person I killed is going to sue the city. It's not coming out of my pocket. And, the city will be out, taxpayers will be out some money. But again, if you don't even live in the city, right, which 94% of our officers don't, why do you even care about that? And so I think that, I think that the residency would matter because people would feel like a more a part of this community. But at the end of the day, without consequences, I think whether it's diversity, residency, you know, without consequences, all training, without consequences, all these things are going to fall by the wayside because there's no real measure of accountability. And I also just want to note that Jen White from the mayor's office is putting some really great info for folks in the chat. So people should take a look at that.
Also from the chat, Gail Spratt is showing love for, says, amen to and for millennials in leadership. So fine, thank you. Y'all take all that love because none of it was intended for me. but I'm going to put out my own shot for boomers in leadership. Let me get to it.
And thank you to Reverend Belton for providing a platform for us to be able to speak and support in our leadership, because that matters.
It does matter.
That, of course, is what we do. It is. I was going to save to the end to remark the there's an interesting historic parallel. Actually, it's not even a parallel. It's just a historic fact of the NAACP and the Urban League sharing a platform to push equity and justice for African Americans. That's exactly where we should be. And the fact that it is cross-generational is part of what works for our community. But let me get to a question from Adam, who asks, can the panelists talk about how education can be more emphasized for our youth as a preventative to criminal activity? More investment should be placed in our youth in terms of defunding. And so I think what he's saying is both the connection,
I know what he's saying here,
but also he's also saying if we're going to defund, maybe some of that refunding or reallocation can be addressed toward our youth. Thoughts on
that? Yeah, but just don't give it to Minneapolis public schools, because we know that they are failing our kids. What I would say to that is we have to be very careful with the narratives that we push. And I'm not saying that you were pushing it, brother. I just want to make sure that it's clear for everyone. I do not believe that our community is made up of criminals. I think that our community is being criminalized. And I think we have to be very careful and intentional about that. I do think that there are a lack of opportunity, resources, and we create environments that lead young people to a certain avenue. I often say that if education is a great equalizer, it's also the great divider. Right. And we know that our kids are not being educated. And we also know that there are systems and institutions that can educate our kids. I used to work in NICAT, the Network for the Development of Children of African Descent. I personally don't think it's any other institution that does as good of a job of creating literacy and actually educating Black families. However, the Minneapolis School Department and many departments have refused to do work with NICAT to actually appropriately educate our kids. And so for me, what COVID, I think, has shown us is that there is not only a need for homeschooling, but there are needs for other alternatives to education. We talk about alternatives. We need alternatives to this public education system that has been stripped. A system that Black people created has been stripped from our communities, mostly through Brown versus Board of Education, which is why I always say we have to be careful about these symbolic wins, because theoretically things have helped us, but in the reality it has hurt us. And so, and also shout out to We Win Institute, who does an amazing job of educating our kids as well. But I'm really a big believer, and to the point of the person that raised the question, we have all the answers. We just need the resources to fund us. And we don't need to, in my opinion, create new institutions, but we need to fund the institutions that are not funded, right? As many people don't know, one of the things that I've been working on,
Bill English, would you put your phone on your mute, please? Your computer on mute. Thank you.
Hey, Elder English. One of the things that I've been really big on is I am trying to build the NAACP up to be sustainable. The NAACP is not sustainable. People complain about the NAACP, but they don't realize that everything I do is done on a voluntary basis, right? And that is not sustainable. And so one of my goals has always been to build up these institutions. So instead of just creating more new institutions, why are we not pouring into the NICATs of the world, the Urban Leagues of the world, the NAACPs of the world, the We Wins of the world, and majorly, the entrepreneurship and the small businesses is what I want to say, and pouring into our institutions that already exist, that have existed, because a lot of time we're trying to recreate the wheel, and I think that's just going to put us back a century.
So let me get to Councilmember Ellison. Did you want to weigh in on this issue of education, or the link between education and policing?
Absolutely. One thing, unfortunately, this is maybe kind of technical, but because the public schools and the parks and the city and the county, they're all sort of their separate institutions. Although we are partnering with the public schools and giving city resources to that. In short, I 100% agree. I think that education is a really important part. We can figure out the details between cross jurisdictional collaboration and all that stuff. I think I agree. The one thing I'll say just in, I think all criticisms are valid of public schools. One thing I'll say in defense of public education is that public education has really been similar to public housing, slowly divested from over the course of many, many, many decades, right? And we get leadership who gets into, whether it's at the schools or at the parks or at the city or whatever, at the state, we have leadership who maybe is in office for a handful of years, and they're trying to dig out this hole, right? This institutional racism. They're trying to pull an institution out of this racist practice that's been in place for you know, 50, 60, 70 years or much, much longer. You know, I do want to say, like, a couple of years ago, the federal government was, for instance, was supposed to give the Minneapolis public schools, I think, $33 million that just never came. And then all of a sudden, our school board is scrambling to have to cut $33 million from the budget. And so I think those are the kinds of things that are that happen that set up our public institutions to fail. But on top of that, though, I think that there does need to be better vetting of curriculum. And those are the things that you can't blame on the institutions on the broader scale. You just have to kind of lean in and do them at an individual basis.
And Councilmember Ellison, we brought up all these points and they continue to ignore us. And that's why I blame the institution, and I blame them because they get rid of people like Bernadia Johnson, mm-hmm. and they bring in people that actually don't know our community, don't actually support our community. Yeah. And we get the answers and they still don't listen to us. But I'm sorry. Go.
No. I think all of that is incredibly valid. And I think
I'm aware that we mentioned reference, and I think it was Councilmember Ellison reference, what was going on in New York, where they're looking at pulling $1 billion out of their police budget. There's another potential reference here to New York or another model. So the city of New York has authority over the public schools in New York. And so the mayor of New York City is in effect the commissioner, or has authority to, and actually has the authority to hire the chief of schools in the city of New York. And so you've got one big charter amendment underway. I'm wondering, you're talking about legislative change, Councilmember Ellison, I wonder, is it contemplated? I don't need to be starting no mess, and I'm not trying to speak heresy, but I'm wondering, is it contemplated among there that clearly, I think what everybody agree, even the school system agree, is that public schools are failing our kids, and it's unfortunately and sadly, Leslie and Councilmember Ellison, is not just if it were just the Minneapolis public schools, then I would love to be able to send those kids to somewhere where they're not failing our kids, some public school system, because there are others that are not failing. But Minneapolis public schools is failing our kids. I'm wondering, is there any discussion in any of the tables that you're at, Councilmember Ellison, or that you're aware of, Leslie, that where people are talking about changing the governance of our public schools and maybe handing them over to a municipal authority or to some other elected process because they are not working?
I was going to say, I haven't seen those discussions happening, at least at the leadership level. I haven't seen them happening, and that doesn't mean that they shouldn't happen, but one thing I will say is that we've seen those types of things happen in places like New Orleans and Chicago, and they have not necessarily, you know, handing over mayors control over the schools hasn't necessarily produced great outcomes for Black and brown students. And
yeah, so I'm not lifting up the New York public city public schools as a model for Black education at all. But, even though, in full transparency, my son works for the New York City public schools.
Okay.
And I get it.
So I think that I'd be open to those conversations, but I probably wouldn't want to have like the council or the mayor having control over an institution that we haven't had control over and that's been largely independent for a long time. So that's all I'll say about that. The one thing somebody mentioned earlier, I wasn't able to address this, was that do people not want to solve these issues because some people benefit from those issues? And I think that the short answer is probably some people do benefit, but I will say that I don't feel like I'm in relationship with anybody that benefits from people feeling insecure about their safety. In North Minneapolis, right, we have I think that addressing public safety is traumatic and twofold. One is that you might be trying to just enjoy your day when you experience gunfire, right? The second, which is traumatic in and of itself. Yep. I think the second level of trauma is that you then have, and I hear from constituents all the time, a large portion of constituents who, even if they do end up calling 911, they have that brief hesitation to call 911. Some of them don't at all. And they have that brief hesitation to call 911 because they're also afraid for the police to show up and escalate the situation or kill someone, and they don't want that on their conscience. And so in my mind, we need to have a public safety system. Nobody deserves to hesitate to call 911 if they feel like their safety is insecure, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so in my mind, we need to create a public safety system, that safety system where people don't question whether or not they can call 911 and get support for them and their neighbors. Right now, I don't feel like we fully have that. It breaks my heart every single time I get those text messages from the inspector of the 4th Precinct. And while the 4th Precinct has problems, the inspector of the 4th Precinct has actually been a great partner in helping me and Councilmember Cunningham understand the magnitude of these problems. But I'll get those text messages or those calls at 3 in the morning, 2 in the morning, 4 o'clock. And when you see that there's been another, you know, there's been another shooting or there's been another homicide, that breaks your heart. I wanna live in a world in which that is rare in North Minneapolis as it is anywhere else in the world. I think education can be a pathway to that. But I also just wanted to name, because that person had made that comment and I wasn't able to address it.
So part of the part of the challenge, and we're actually at our time. We're at 2:13. We've got another.
Can I just quickly respond to that initial question about education? Really quick.
The question, Leslie Redmond, is can you quickly respond to that?
Yes, I can. Let me go ahead and do it real quick. I don't think that we should just change from plantation to plantation when we're talking about education system. It's not just about who's the owner of it. It's about actually radically rethinking it. And I think, again, Black people who were recently enslaved created what we knew as the public education system, and it was completely transformed after Brown versus Board of Education and taken away from us. So again, I would just talk about the fact that we have the answers, and when we're talking about reducing violence in the inner city, we really need to talk about poverty. We really need to talk about white supremacy being at the root of all of this if we truly want transformation. There you go, Reverend Belton.
So thank you. And you delivered on time as usual. So let me thank Leslie Redmond, who was our special guest, and Councilmember Jeremiah Ellison, who was our surprise guest, although he did let us know that he was going to be available. But I'm delighted that both of you have been here. I hope it was our intent to draw in the voices of the people who dial into or log on to Real Talk for you to have an opportunity to share. I hope you felt like you did, hope you felt like your voice was heard, but this discussion is not going away. This issue is not going away. Someone has already lifted up, I think it was Leslie Redmond, that, you know, we didn't get in this situation overnight, that the system of white supremacy and the weaponization of racism did not happen overnight. We are not going to resolve this overnight. One of the things that I am frankly delighted about and encouraged about is that this sense of public outrage and engagement has legs. It is not an episodic deal. It is not simply a trend that is going away. We are going to be looking at demonstrations and speaking out in a variety of ways, hopefully not destructive ways, but people are going to move this agenda forward. And so you can look forward to continued conversations about this issue. We need everybody engaged across demographics. We need allies in this discussion, but we also need a fully engaged African-American community to use its capacity for problem solving, but also to exercise its voice. Every voice matters in this conversation. And so thank you for being a part of this. Thank you for speaking your truth. And thank you for making Real Talk real talk. So have a great day.
Apologize for crashing the party. But thank you, Reverend Belton and Leslie. It's always an honor to share a stage with you. So thank you.
Thanks so
always
much.
Grace and peace, everyone. Reverend Belton, text me back.
I will. There will be some announcements on the screens as we leave. But again, have a blessed weekend. Be safe, everybody.
Mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find to bring some loving here today. Don't need to escalate. See, war is not the answer for all that love can comprehend. You know.
Reverend Belton?
Yeah.
I just wanted to say hi real quick. My name is Kristen Helling, and I go to Unity Minneapolis, and I've followed you there for a long time. So I just wanted to give a shout out.
You're at Unity Minneapolis, did you say?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, so my brother David has there been there for a long time.
Yeah, yeah, that's what I was thinking. There's some connection here with the very similar, same last name.
Thanks. What brings you to Real Talk?
Well, I've been trying to find ways that I can get more involved in, as a white person, like how can I educate more white people, including myself. I've been on this journey for a couple of years, and I'm just really kind of digging in now. So I'm just, looking at all the resources out there of how I can be of service in any way.
How'd you find out about it?
I'm not sure. I follow so many activists. I'm not exactly sure who led me in this direction, to be honest.
Well, I'm glad you got led.
Thank you.
Have a great day.
Thanks. Take care.
Bye-bye. Reverend Belton?
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you for the work and the grace that you bring to us as Native Minnesotans.
You are welcome, and you don't get to say that because you're my sister. So
I am.
Thank you, Renee.
Reverend Belton?
Yes.
Thank you for this opportunity to hear this discussion today. I see you didn't get to my question.
You were raising questions about education, as I recall, or about...
No, the Camden.
The Camden issue, yeah.
The Camden issue. It's okay, because there's going to be more discussions. But I think I've been trying to tune in to Real Talk as often as I can, but it seems like Fridays at 1 o'clock, there's so many things going on. And I have to try to decide which one, but I was glad I was able to get in today. And I think these kinds of discussions are important. I'm not surprised that you're leading it. And thank you again. You know how proud I am of your service and how much I respect your leadership.
And, I appreciate it. I owe you a call, by the way, so I will call you or text you when this is over later this afternoon. But I'm going to catch up about the investment.
Okay. All right.
Development fund. So thank you.
All right. Take care.
All right, everybody. I'm signing off of Real Talk. So have a great day. Bye.
Adios.
Adios.